Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in to Altium Academy. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna be talking about something that I think new designers might struggle with, which is how to compare manufacturing services for your circuit board. So what should you be looking for when you start talking to a manufacturer? And should you just focus on fabrication or just on assembly? Should you try and assemble it yourself? Let's get into it and talk about some of the stuff you should think about before you start working with a manufacturer. If you're like me and you design PCBs and you make that known publicly, sometimes what you will start getting is a lot of spam from manufacturers.
So here's some of the stuff that I tend to get. Someone offering to sell me a bunch of capacitors, I guess. But here's kind of the thing I'm talking about where it's like hard to really tell all these folks apart. They all do HDI via in-pad, multi-layer PCB, up to 30 layers. Again, that's a bit high. Here you can see, okay, you know, they're listing their lead times for different layer counts. Again, the stuff that they can produce. And so just, you know, looking at all of these, and by the way, you can see the dates here. It's like the 26th, the 27th. Here's another one. The very next day, 28th. Again, 24 layer FR4, aluminum, you know, all really common stuff that you would expect to see any PCB manufacturer tell you in an email. So, I mean, how do you pick between all these different things?
I don't know why these guys feel the need to spam me, but I swear I get like 10 emails a day at all my different email addresses trying to get me to go with some manufacturer that I've never heard of. And I get it, you know, they gotta find customers and make an income. So I'm not knocking them too hard. But I will say this, when you start to get 10 different emails a day asking you to fabricate your 48 layer board with some random overseas manufacturer, you start to wonder, how do you actually compare all of these guys? Who should you select to manufacture your next PCB? It's kind of a golden question, and there's a lot of different things to think about when you're selecting a PCB manufacturer. I think what a lot of hobbyists do is they just focus on price. And if you're just building something that's really simple, you're gonna assemble it yourself, you're maybe not so worried about lead time, you don't have to worry about any specific industry standards, maybe you're not designing to class 2 or class 3 under IPC, then you can usually go overseas, find somebody who's gonna fabricate your board for like, you know, $5 or $10 a board, and they'll ship them back to you, you can assemble it yourself, and everything's gonna be all good. Is that gonna be right for every project? Probably not. There are some projects that need really fine capabilities. We've talked about this in terms of HDI and just in terms of trace impedance generally. So some manufacturers need very tight clearances and very fine capabilities in order to be able to fabricate that stuff. Some manufacturers, they might need to fabricate something with really high layer count. Maybe you need controlled impedance, so you need a specific stack up. These are all different things to think about. One of the places where I like to start, it really is lead time. So this is one of the things that is more important for me and the stuff that I work on, because generally the clients I work with have very important deadlines that they might need to meet. So I don't want to go overseas and have them take 4 weeks to fabricate the board and then another 2 weeks to do assembly. We might need something that is fabbed in the week, assembled the next week, delivered overnight, and we're under 3 weeks for the entire project. Sometimes that happens. So lead time is usually, for me, the biggest driver of who I'm gonna select. Some companies will have different lead times for different projects. Some companies are a lot better at actually standardizing their quoting process, and you can actually go online and you'll be able to get prices for different lead times in order to figure out which is gonna be the best option for you. Now, sometimes the lead time also varies with capability, and sometimes for different capabilities that are needed, you actually need to get a custom quote. And it may not just be a standard lead time. You know, it may be like a 5 day or an 8 day or even a 14 day fab time followed by, you know, 1 week or a 2 week assembly time. So lead time can be very important if you do this professionally. Maybe you work for like a manufacturer and they have to outsource something to an external fab house. Lead time is always important. So in general, if your lead time goes down, meaning you want the board faster, what's gonna happen to cost? Well, cost is gonna go up, and sometimes it can go way up. So the difference between like an 8-day and a 5-day lead time is not gonna be so big as the difference between like a 5-day and a 2-day lead time. So why is that? The reason is that there's actually a lot of NRE, or non-recurring engineering costs, that go in to the front end of your project in order to set your board up so that it can be fabricated in their process. So one of the things that they have to do is they have to make stencils. They have to do some programming on their equipment. So these are the two big ones, is they have to do some of this. And then sometimes they have to order materials. And they just pass all this stuff on to you as the customer, okay? So there's some NRE costs involved. That takes a little bit of time. When you go to shorter lead time, cost goes up because they gotta do all this stuff faster. They're gonna push off other projects, or they're gonna have to have people working overtime to do this. So that's where the costs come in. Lead time is the biggest thing for me, might not be the biggest thing for you. After lead time, people generally start looking at something like capabilities. So clearances are a big one. So stuff like trace to trace, trace to pad, pad to pad, and so on and so forth. So just on down the line, there are all sorts of different clearances. So most fabricators should be able to reliably handle something in the neighborhood of like, you know, 3 to maybe 6 mil capability limits on a lot of different stuff. There's also, so this was under clearances, but there's also something like, what's the minimum trace width that they can fabricate reliably? So if you have a board and you've proposed a layer stack that requires 3 mil trace widths, you're not gonna be able to take that to every single fabricator. You may have to go to a very specialized fabricator that can do less than 5 mil trace widths. Most fabricators can handle down to 5 mil really reliably. So if you go down to 5 mil as your limit, you're gonna be safe most of the time. But again, this stuff like clearances, trace width, that's gonna be stuff that a good fabricator will put on their website. So make sure to check their website for their capabilities. And a lot of places, again, if they're really good, they want your business, they're gonna have a link right at the top of the homepage that says capabilities. Click on that, go read through it. So as far as costs involved with this, some manufacturers will have multiple processes. And what I mean by that is that they will charge you or quote you at different rates depending on the size of trace or the clearances that you need, okay? So in general, as you get these values smaller, what happens to your cost? Cost is gonna go up. So don't be surprised when you send in a board that has very small trace widths and you don't actually tell them on a quote form what the trace widths are, and you get an idea of cost in your head, and then they email you back and they say, oh, it's actually this cost, which is much higher. And it's because you might not have accounted for stuff like trace widths. Now, in terms of clearances, sometimes if you violate these clearances, your board will actually receive what's called no bid status. So meaning they don't want to bid on it because they know that whatever you've given them will not make it through their process. Now, if they are actually a good manufacturer and they want your business, what they'll do is they will call out, hey, specifically these particular issues in your board are what are causing us to give you a no bid status. And they'll tell you, you know, hey, increase your pad to pad distance by a certain level. Or a really common one that I've even, you know, mistaken before, or that a client has essentially asked me to violate before, is via to via. So what I mean by this is not necessarily the pad to pad per via, it's actually the drill hole to drill hole in copper pour. So drill to drill distance is important because drill has some wander, and they want to make sure that if you say, hey, I need these two vias spaced by, you know, 5 mils, let's say, that they can actually fabricate that reliably. 5 mils is really small for via to via. So just keep that in mind because you're most likely not going to be able to do that with mechanical drilling. Okay, so next is quantity. And in general, it's the quantity that you need at the desired lead time. Not all manufacturers can crank out 10 million boards in a week. They would have to stagger that because there's finite production capacity in any factory. If you need like a short run, maybe it's just one panel of 10 boards and they're gonna do it at a certain lead time, they're gonna quote you one cost. Obviously, as your quantity goes up, the cost will go up as well. If you double quantity, so let's say I go to, you know, 2x quantity, I actually don't get 2x the cost. So this does not necessarily happen. And that's because of those NRE charges. So the NRE charges go into all the tooling that's needed to be able to fabricate the board. And then same thing kind of goes with assembly. So there's these upfront costs. However, that's just the cost to produce a single panel worth of boards. So if I double the number of panels that I want, essentially the only added cost is machine time, and then the additional laminate materials and any other chemicals involved that are used to produce the board. So those NRE costs get amortized across all of the panels that you want to produce. So just because you double the quantity doesn't necessarily mean that you double the cost. So if you have a big budget and you want to get a few extra boards and you're already producing at a reasonable volume, you can always order an extra panel, get it assembled, and then you've got some extra boards just in case if you need them. Same thing here with quantity at lead time. If I then decrease the lead time as well as increase the quantity, you could actually get to a situation where you double the cost or more than double the cost if you want to get really short lead times. So again, these are all important aspects to think about when you are going out and getting quotes for your project. So I always say this to newer designers because I want to tell them, don't be surprised when you start seeing how some of these numbers change. You might wonder, hey, I can produce, you know, 5 boards for the same cost as I can produce 15 bare boards. Well, the reason is that you didn't actually double the quantity. When you're on a quote form, you're talking about the number of bare boards you want fabricated and assembled. However, fabricators produce panels. They don't produce individual boards. If they want to produce one board that's maybe a 3x3 inch board, or they want to produce 8 of those that are 3x3 inch boards, what they're going to do is they're going to line those up in a panel and they're going to produce the entire panel. So the panel is what determines the cost and not necessarily the individual number of boards. And even then, doubling the quantity of panels does not just automatically double the total cost of the project. So far I've been talking about bare board fabrication, but the same kind of ideas go into assembly costs. So if we're talking about assembly, we also have to deal with quantity at lead time. And again, don't be surprised if you have to decrease your lead time a little bit, you do see a slight increase in cost. However, just like with fabrication, if I go from, let's say, 5-day lead time on bare board fabrication to 48-hour lead time, I'm gonna see a bigger increase than if I go from, you know, 10-day to 5-day. Assembly also comes with its own NRE costs. So assemblers will be programming some automated machines. They're gonna program their pick and place. They're gonna program their SMT line. They're probably also going to program any automated inspection equipment that they use. So they're gonna have some upfront costs that they incur, and they pass those on to you as part of your project. So just like with bare board fabrication, those NRE costs get amortized over the entire quantity of boards that you want to produce. Same thing goes with assembly. So if you're just going to assemble, you know, 5 boards, if I multiply my number of boards I want to assemble by 10, it's not necessarily the case that my assembly cost is going to multiply by 10. Maybe it multiplies by 3 or 4, but it's not necessarily going to multiply by 10. Just keep that in mind, because as you scale, you start to take advantage of some of those cost reductions as you get to higher and higher tiers. Okay, so the next thing that I want to bring up that goes into your manufacturing costs and also your lead time and everything are some of the little extras that are needed when you're looking through manufacturing services. So what do I mean by little extras? Well, generally, you can add on services like electrical testing. So you can get continuity testing added on to your board at usually a pretty small fee. At the most basic level, this is gonna check for opens and shorts where they expect to find opens and shorts. So what they'll do is they'll look at your net list, they'll be able to see, hey, I need to have continuity between these two nodes in the net list, and then they can actually see, oh yes, with the electrical test, we have continuity, meaning a short. And then they can also see where they don't have shorts or where they have open circuits, just like you would expect from looking at the net list. Another important test that's done is controlled impedance. So if you are producing a board that has a high frequency or high speed signaling on it, and you aren't sure of the impedance or if the impedance that you've designed is correct, they can actually do a test, a controlled impedance test, on the stack up and make sure that what you've designed will actually hit their spec. Now, ideally, you should contact them early and get the stack up that they are going to build your board on. So that way you will have much greater assurance that the board that you design with their stack up and with their required trace width and materials and dielectric constant and everything is gonna hit the impedance target that you need. Now, this is just an additional test. If you have controlled impedance lines on your board, you don't have to do a controlled impedance test. This is more for your assurance. This is so you can sleep at night. Some other important points, IPC inspection levels. So IPC classes have their specific inspection levels that go into them. And if you go to IPC class 3, you will pay quite a bit more for inspection. However, this is required for very high reliability products like you will find in the defense and aerospace industry. So this is another little add-on. And there are other add-ons that you can get. You can get UL markings. You can have UL testing added on. But a big one, if you're ever gonna go to market at high volume with a new product, is underwriter's labs. So the UL testing is very important. These are the four big ones that you need to think about if you're gonna go to market or if you're working in a specialized industry that has high reliability requirements. UL also carries some requirements on power products. So if you're going to market with any kind of power product that has any sort of safety issues that might be associated with it, good to get UL certification if it's required. Some other points to look out for if you happen to need them from your manufacturer. Castellated edges. Castellated modules, what are those? So if you've ever bought one of those little ESP, I think 8266 is the number, those little ESP modules, they come with an array of like half cut holes along the edge of the board. There are a number of other modules that come packaged like that too. That's what they're talking about, is if your board needs to have castellated edges. Some companies can do that for you. They may do it at a nominal fee that you have to add on to your fab order. Plated edges, meaning the entire side of the board is plated up with copper, and then that is overlaid or plated with an additional plating material, Enig, Enipig, Immersion Silver, one of these. The plating material as well influences the cost. So this is another important one because most boards that are just basic boards will go with tin lead, SNPB, so tin lead plating. But if you're doing anything like class 2 or if you need to go to like RF and you need to work at very high frequencies, you may need an alternative plating. So we talked a little bit about this when we looked at what happens with controlled impedance microstrips near ground pour. We actually saw that the plating influences the losses in those channels when you're at very high frequency. So alternative platings, I'll just write a couple of them. Enig, Immersion, Silver, sometimes written IMAG, but Immersion Silver. Your manufacturer will have a list of the different platings that you might need for your board. We actually have a blog article that's linked in the description that describes and compares the different platings that are used in PCBs. If you're not familiar with all the plating options, go check that out. Okay, the last one I'm gonna go over is via fill, or sometimes called via plug. Basically means the same thing. So do you need to have all your vias filled in with either conductive or non-conductive epoxy? So these are more for specialty applications. In terms of via fill for like a dense board, what you might actually have is via in pad. And in that case, you do want to fill up those vias so that we have a nice flat surface where assembly can then reliably solder your components onto those pads. So via fill, via plug needed in high density stuff. Some specialized applications might need it too. So if you need that, just make sure your manufacturer can do it. All right, everybody. So this is a list of stuff that you should think about when you're going to compare and choose a PCB manufacturing service. Obviously, look on the quote form, look at their capabilities, just make sure that they can do the minimum that you need. And if they can go above and provide some extras, definitely worth considering. Go ahead and hit that like button, hit that subscribe button. If you have questions, leave them in the comment section because we love to get your questions. This is definitely one of those times where you can't forget to call your fabricator.